Deepak, over to you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Indian Society for Success Surgery welcomes today's speaker, Dr. P.K. Gahlot, sir, and all the participants to this webinar. As we all know, Dr. P.K. Gahlot, sir, but still a brief introduction about Gahlot, sir. Dr. Tarun Kumar Gahlot is working as a professor in Department of Veterinary Surgery and Radiology, College of Veterinary and Animal Sciences, Rajuwas, Bikaner. He did his BBSc and AS degree from University of Udaipur in 1979 and Master's in Veterinary Surgery from Sukhadeva University, Udaipur in 1982. Then he did his PhD from Haryana Agricultural University, Hisar in 1989. He is actively involved in teaching, research and extension activities and guided more than 50 MBSC students and more than 8 PhD students as major advisor. He is a member of Research Advisory Committee of IVRI Izzatnagar and National Research Center on Yak, Dehrang, Arunachal Pradesh. Dr. Gahlot was invited as OIE Camel Expert at Paris, France and visited many countries including UAE, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Germany, Iran, Israel, Kenya, Libya, Sudan, and many more to represent camel research of India. He has edited many books, which include Camel Surgery, and contributed a chapter in Ruminant Surgery and Veterinary Radiology. He has also edited selected topics on camelids, selected bibliography on camelids, research, selected research on camelid physiology and nutrition, selected research on camelid parasitology, selected research on grass anatomy and histology of camels. Apart from this, he has published more than 120 research and clinical papers in international and national journals and presented more than 50 papers in various symposiums and conferences organized at national and international levels. He has also received many awards, including Fellow Indian Society for Veterinary Surgery, MBSC Gold Medal Award, S.J. Angelo Memorial Award, Dr. Rao Bahadur Swaminatha Iyer Memorial Award, Rao Bikaji Trust for Outstanding Camel Veterinarian Award, Camel Savior Award 2010 for doing outstanding research in camel science and various best paper presentation in different conferences. He has also worked as Joint Secretary for Indian Society for Veterinary Surgery. So I request Dr. Tarun Kumar Gahlot sir to deliver today's webinar.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. Thank you for giving me the opportunity again. Hope you are listening me. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Kind of all good.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
So, friends, I'm really thankful to INTAS and ISVS to giving me another opportunity to speak on current trends in surgical diagnosis in equine clinical entities. Greetings of Diwali, Christmas and New Year in advance. One very famous idiom is that the little neglect may breed mischief. For want of a nail, the shoe was lost. For want of a shoe, the horse was lost. And for want of a horse, the rider was lost. It was said by Benjamin Franklin, who was the father of United States. Now, keeping equines gives you many benefits, and they say that it gives equine therapy. There is emotional awareness, there is social skill, there is impulse control, there is confidence, trust and empathy, the problem solving skills. In retrospect, many things would have been incomplete without a horse. All the wars were fought on the back of the horse. All the dacoits were incomplete without a horse. Agriculture was incomplete without a horse. It was flowing. Sport was incomplete without a horse, even as on today. See the show jumping, other sports, the horse equestrian vaulting, acrobatics, tent pegging, even by the NCC cadets, polo, rodeo. Then many royal ceremonies still people are using horses, you know, as a tradition. And the horses are pride of RVC. They are keeping equines. They have big stud farms at two, three places. Now, how to learn equine surgery? Every vet cannot be an equine surgeon. You have to learn equine surgery. You have to be familiar with horse before surgery. Learn restraint and anesthesia protocols. You cannot restrain it like you are restraining a cow or some other animal. Learn handling horse with slings and hoist system during induction and recovery. That's different from other species. Then experience the difference. Now, books are best friend of equine surgeons. When they are doing any equine surgery, they must consult the books. Now, we have practical surgical techniques on artificial skin, which bleeds. So Surgireal is a body wall model developed by Colorado State Equine Surgeons and many other agencies. They are also selling these. Syndeva surgical training models are there. These are surgical simulators that provide you a realistic and tactile training experience. Now, if you want to learn equine surgery, you have to learn about equine hospital outdoor, about the facilities of equine hospital indoors. Learn ABCD of equine surgery through practical sessions conducted by most experienced equine surgeons. General anesthesia facilities, induction and intubation. These are really different from other species one must learn. Learning about operation theater facilities and etiquettes. These are very important for the equine surgeons. Now, before going for surgery, you have to have certain diagnosis in your hand so that you decide the prognosis. So veterinary diagnostics are computer-aided diagnostic equipment that help deciding about pre-anesthetic evaluation before equine surgery. You know, many instruments like veterinary hematology analyzer, semi-automatic chemistry analyzer, portable veterinary monitor, and you all know that what parameters they just show you. If you want to record ECG, there's a cardioscope, and say it's so easy to listen the sound and to record the ECG on the horse. Then imaging diagnosis. You know, this is a big diagnostic tool for equines, for because mainly equines are used for racing purposes, breeding purposes, draft purposes. So you need to go for imaging diagnosis using digital radiography, fluoroscopy, ultrasonography, scintigraphy for diagnosis of the tumor, for the organ function and structure, for positron emission tomography, CT scan, and MRI. Now, portable digital radiography, it's available everywhere these days. Standing MRI in horses, this is really in need of the hour to detect the foot problems. MRI scanning, you can see. Then thermography in equines, as you know that there is inflammation, and inflammation causes pain in lameness. So thermography is a very important tool to detect the temperature, high temperature zones, and you can detect, you can do the thermal scan. And we just detect the pinpoint high inflammation area. Then ultrasonography is a very, very important tool for equines, you know, not only for the diagnosis of pregnancy, but to diagnose gastrointestinal problems, to diagnose the tendon and ligament injuries. So you can see that how they do it and how important this is. Now, if you want to see left side organs, then you must know the anatomical landmarks to put probe on the left side to see the stomach, spleen, kidney, rectum, intestine, colon, liver, heart, lungs. If you want to see right side, then you can see the small intestine, you can see large colon, cecum, small colon, rectum. So we should know the anatomy also. Now, if you want to place the probe at the area designated as A, you can see the spleen and liver. You put it on B, you can see spleen and stomach. You put it on C, you can see the spleen and lower kidney, left kidney, and then if you put on D, then it is spleen and small intestine. Distant and intestine lobes in case of colic, you know, they just are quite diagnostic in cases of abdominal ultrasonography. Evaluation of eye and adenexa with equine ocular disease, it's helpful for tendon inflammation, adhesions. It is very important. You can see a sonogram showing superficial distal flexor tendon, deep distal flexor tendon, check ligament, suspensory ligament, and we just know that which is inflamed, where is the adhesion. Now, imaging diagnosis using digital X-ray shows you very clearly the pathology involved, and you reach on diagnosis very quickly. Then plain radiography is there. Then CT scan of head is very, very important in the horses. CT scan of head and neck and the body. Then MRI is really very important tool. This all has to be done under general anesthesia, particularly MRI, to diagnose the lameness even. Open bore MRI for equines is also important. Then nuclear medicine technology, where we are using radioisotopes to detect the structure and function of the organs, to detect the tumor or any other pathology. This is really very important. And you can see here a bone scan, and animal is standing in front of a gamma camera, and scintigraphy, that's a bone scanning, is there, and you can see the instant, the picture or a bone scan. Now, portable PET scanner is these days quite popular, and as you know, that positron emission tomography, and this is really a very important tool to diagnose various type of lameness. And these instruments are not in many of the veterinary colleges or institutes. They are available only in few, but it's coming up now. Now, interpretation of images, that's very, very important. You know, these days we can store all the images, then you can interpret it later on and can reach on diagnosis. Say, for example, how the bone scan will look like. You can see the images, this will look like this. Digital X-rays. Now, if you see digital X-ray, they show the pathology, which you can see in this red square, red circle. Now, the infection of cheek tooth detected in CT scan. Now, with this red arrow, you can see, and this is impossible to detect by even digital X-ray. So, CT scan is quite helpful. Now, the 3D construction of an image with the CT scan is helpful in reaching many diagnoses. See the horizontal fracture over here. This is fracture of first phalanx. You can see that is detected here in radiograph as well. Now, here also, you can see the osteochondroma of first phalanx, and a 3D image is there, and you can see radiographically also the osteochondroma. But MRI tells you about the soft tissue, and see the equine encephalitis. This is normal, and here this is inflamed one, and you can see the accumulation of the inflammatory fluid over this. So that's how it makes a difference. Now, PET scan, positron emission tomography scanner, with a small dose of radioactivity, detect microscopic changes of bone and cartilage. That's a really upcoming diagnostic tool. MRI images of equine foot is many times important, particularly for diagnosis of the navicular disease over here. See navicular edema, you can detect over here, which is otherwise not possible to diagnose. Now, topmost five common health problem of equines, we all know that colic, arthritis, desmitis or tendinitis, gastric ulcers, and laminitis. Now, if you want to evaluate equine surgical case, then you should include muscle, bone, joint disorders. You should include acute abdominal pain if it is a colic case. You should see reproductive disorder. You should see dental and airway disease. You should see lacerations and wounds. Now, ideal equine surgical unit must have four separate surgical suits. Now, it's not present everywhere, but in a very highly specialized clinic in US, these are there. One is for the standing surgery. Now, many surgeries are done in a standing position, and you should have the tools for standing surgery and all the equipments which can help in standing surgery. Second, for the soft tissue surgery. Now you see, for the colic surgery, abdominal surgery, we have different kind of facility. So this suit is different. Third is orthopedic surgery. It is a dedicated room which facilitates premium surgery for highly specialized procedures such as orthopedic cases, where you can see the X-ray, you can take even distal X-ray, and then you can do the orthopedic maneuvering. Then abdominal or gastrointestinal surgery, you need a dedicated room which facilitates premium surgery for highly specialized procedures such as orthopedic cases or upper airway surgery, abdominal surgeries. The large standing area supports minimally invasive surgery procedure like laparoscopy in this dedicated operation theater. The surgery rooms are complemented by dedicated and safest induction and recovery rooms in a controlled environment. And you must acquaint yourself with all these. Handling of specialized instrument needs safety of eyes of surgeon, you know. You are doing laser surgery, you must wear goggles. So it's very much essential that while doing equine surgery, you should know that how to handle the instrument and what to wear accordingly. Now, induction and maintenance of general anesthesia gives you certain caution points. So for example, always prevent compartment syndrome. This is different from that of cattle and other species, and not in canine even. All recommended animals are susceptible to compartment syndrome, particularly those breeds which are heavy in weight, draft horses, heavy muscled horses. They develop post-anesthetic myopathy or neuropathy, which is a leading cause of injury or death. The percentage is as high as 5%. So you have to be highly careful. Minimize anesthetic time. You know, if it is more than 1 hour, you should be quite cautious. Try to finish it as early as possible. Maintain anesthesia only as deeply as necessary, because blood pressure drops as the depth of anesthesia increases. And use adequate padding, which should be a thick foam mattress, 15 to 20 centimeter thick, so that it doesn't presses the blood supply. General anesthetic being used in equines these days, if you are using intravenous, then propofol, ketamine, etomidate we are using. If you are using inhalation anesthesia, then isoflurane is the most widely used volatile inhalation anesthetic agent, because it has lowest MAC, requiring the lowest alveolar concentration to abolish motor response. Others are sevoflurane, desflurane, halothane, nitrous oxide. Now, you should have facilities for general anesthesia. That's a padded walls, padded floor should be there. Then you should have a hoist system to carry horse from induction room to the operation theater, and it should be put on the operation table. It should be intubated. It should be well positioned. Always keep the both forelimb and hind limb elevated and parallel to the ground when you are taking it in a lateral recumbency. That is very much necessary. Otherwise, there is a pressure on the triceps. Then you should know about the recovery room. Once the surgery is finished, it is brought to the recovery room, and you have to help the horse to get up. You have to assist it to get up. And in many universities, they have in US a unique pool recovery system that awakes safely from the anesthesia, and they put the horse, anesthetized horse, for recovery in the pool. Now, in New Bolton anesthesia recovery pool, it's there, and it was made many years ago, four decades ago even. Now, to describe the equine surgery or to discuss the equine surgery, we have to classify this. Otherwise, there will be intermingling of all the topics. So, we have divided this in the soft tissue surgery, surgery of sinuses and teeth, orthopedic surgery, arthroscopic surgery, lameness, podiatry, that's a surgery for the and care for the foot, and cosmetic and reconstructive surgery. Let us first go on the soft tissue surgery, that how this is being done. As we know that the gastrointestinal tract is a soft tissue, and the very first problem in the soft tissue is the choke, and you have to use even trans endoscopic manipulation of obstructed feet bolus can be done and it can be removed. Abdominal hernias, yeah, this is a problem. Many times you have to repair this, herniorrhaphy has to be done, and you can see the muscle is ruptured and contents, they come below the skin, and repair can be done by mesh, by glycerolized bovine pericardium, tunica vaginalis. Many materials can be used even without hernioplasty. You can do simple herniorrhaphy as well. Laparoscopic repair of inguinal hernia is very popular, and it is being done by transabdominal preperitoneal approach. Now, after repair, then you have to put a protective dressing around the operated site. Now, many equine standing interventions are used in recent years. The castration is done in standing position, ovariectomy is done, triptorchidectomy is done, castration is done, ovaries and retained testicles are removed in standing position, and many of these are done by laparoscopic method. Upper airway surgery is done by laser, and we call this as upper airway laser surgery, and you have to use the specific instrument for this purpose. And here in this picture you can see that how it reaches to arytenoid cartilage and up to the cricoid one, and it repairs. And here you can see that pre-surgery, you can see the there was a stenosis of the airway, and after surgery, post-surgery, you can see the airway is quite patent. Now, laryngoplasty, this is combined with the bilateral ventriculectomy or ventriculocordectomy, is done in standing position by endoscopic surgery. You can see here, and you have to use a tieback technique to correct airway collapse. And here you can see laryngoplasty is done, and two very strong sutures are applied on muscular process of arytenoid and cricoid cartilage, and the horse is considered to be tied back, hence the name of surgery is tied back technique. And we are using a special thing, like a special head support, head and neck garment, and that include a blind on the left eye and surgical draping, and that helps in doing the surgery. Now, laryngoplasty is done here again, you can see in a standing position. Now, ophthalmic surgery, this is also very important for the horse, and we must understand the anatomy of the eye very first. What are different parts of the eye? As you know, in other species, it's quite similar. And we know, we see here that if there is one ulcer, you have to carry out the fluorescent eye test. You can see here, keyhole keratoplasty for the corneal ulcer, it is being done. Nerve blocks are being done. Dr. S.K. Jirwal, our ophthalmologist, must be looking this with a great interest. Eye worms, that's the ocular satyriasis infected by Thalassia lacrimalis, is also very common in horses, and then you have to remove by entering into the anterior chamber, and it should be removed. The Thalassia larva, you can see here on the corneal surface. In ultrasound also, you can see this worm, and with this yellow arrow, you can see this. Uveal cyst, you can see. Anterior synechia, you can diagnose. Dermoids, you can see, and you can remove by superficial keratectomy. Chronic superficial keratitis, the squamous is there. Then tumor at third eyelid is there. Squamous cell carcinoma of third eyelid is there. Ocular neoplasia, common. Eyelid lacerations are there. And corneal opacity, that is the edema of the cornea, swollen cornea, you can see. Then corneal foreign bodies are there, which should be carefully removed. Then corneal ulcer with opacity is there. Desmatocele was there. And here you can see keratoplasty was done. On the left side pictures, you can see before operation, but in right side pictures, you can see after penetrating keratoplasty, there is the cornea is quite clear over here. So this is quite successful. Now, as we cannot administer the medication to the eye, there is a subpalpebral irrigation system in the horse, and you can see that how the subpalpebral system is put through the medial canthus, and then the other end of the tube is out, and you can administer medicine through the other end. Enucleation, in a case of panophthalmia, the panophthalmic eye is there, you have to carry out the enucleation. Then eyelid tumors are removed by cryosurgery. You can see the cryo probe over here, and this you can see a device protecting the other tissue from the cold temperatures. These days, cataract surgery is being done in equines, and even lens transplantation is being done. Guttural pouch, as you know, that this is present only in horses. It's very, very important. There is a problem in the breathing, so you have to carry out the surgery, and you must know the what is Hubbo's triangle, and you must detect the empyema over there, and this is a clinical case where you can see the swelling just posterior to the mandible, and the empyema of guttural pouches, and tympanitis of guttural pouch, and then you have to operate this, and so that's how this is being done. Then colic surgery in horses is very important, and mostly the colic, the cause of colic lies in the large colon, and there's a right dorsal displacement, but there can be left dorsal displacement also. There can be volvulus, there can be impaction. But impaction is there in cecum as well, small colon as well. And other causes are enterolith and cecocecal or cecocolic intussusception. So these are the possible causes of colic surgery. Now in a colic room, you see there is a pattern, protocol position of team for equine colic surgery, and surgeon will stand where, assistant surgeon will stand where, technician will stand where. So this has to be followed in a structured sense, like this they are standing. And now exploratory ciliotomy is done, and then followed by enterotomy to empty the large colon, which is having impaction. So colic surgery is very, very special and very important. It is done under general anesthesia. In our department, we removed a fecolith in a filly, and you can see the abdomen was greatly distended, and you can see the gases and fluid were there, and with a slight stab given here, gases were released, and then the fecolith was located, and then liquid paraffin was injected into the lumen, and it was mashed up, and it was removed through the rectum. The other person sitting behind took it out from the rectum, and you can see decompressed intestine, and now animal is standing, so highly comfortable, decompressed abdomen is seen. Now in urogenital surgery, that's also a surgery of soft tissue. At the time of falling, sometimes there is a rectovaginal fistula, and it has to be repaired by a 6-bite pattern suture has to be applied, and it has to be done either the same day or after at least 1 month when healing has taken place, and then you have to carry it out, and many times you have to repair the perineum as well. Now Keslik operation or vulvoplasty is very, very important, because these mares, they suck air through the vagina, and it causes metritis, and there is a release of endotoxins, and histamine is released, and there is a laminitis, and so it has to be closed, and only a small passage for the urine is kept open, otherwise the remaining is sutured. We call this as vulvoplasty. Now the albino mares or white mares, they have very common vulvovaginal granulomas over here with the sharp hairs. They are quite irritating hairs, and with this, if there is a wound, they keep on becoming granulating, and in a standing position it can be done, and you can use the electrocautery and see after healing it's done. So sinuses and teeth, they are very important for the horses, because the sinuses, once they are infected, mostly they are infected because of the rotten tooth, their roots, and infection can reach in sinus by hematogenous root as well. So frontal and maxillary sinuses are important. You can see the designated A, these are frontal sinuses, and B1, B2, these are maxillary sinuses. They're very simple to define. You have to carry out the trephining at the anatomical location. If it is a sinusitis of frontal sinus, then in the frontal area. If it is maxillary sinus, then in maxillary area, and then you can drain the fluid and you can carry out the irrigation, flushing. You can see the mucopurulent discharge is coming out through this refined opening. Now, tumefaction is a bony swelling with maxillary sinusitis following chronic alveolar periostitis, and you can see here, this is a tumefaction, a bony swelling is there. And here, repulsion of tooth has to be done and refining has to be done. Granuloma at sinus, we found over here in our department under general anesthesia. It was removed, it was very fragile in nature, and within few minutes it was removed, and then cavity was packed with antiseptic and adrenaline, and after 48 hours it was opened, and then you can see whatever fluid was put here for irrigation was coming out through the respective side nostril. Now, getting to the teeth of the matter, that's equine teeth is very, very important. And once we should know the anatomy of the teeth, that how they are, like incisors, like canines, like premolars and molars, and their respective anatomy, and the instruments like motorized dental rasp. You can see here motorized dental rasp, then manual rasp. You can see here these are manual rasp, and then mouth gag. It is very, very important, mouth gag, to carry out a maneuvering of the, or carry out any dental procedure. Now, any sign of dental disorder, there will be dropping of the food, difficult chewing, excessive salivation, wet loss, head tossing, the excessive bit chewing, difficult handling while riding, mouth odor, blood in mouth, face swelling, nasal discharge, blah, blah, blah. So you should see, open the mouth and see the tooth. There could be alveolar periostitis, that is simple inflammation of periosteum of alveolus. Infection gets entered with the food material through imperfectly closed infundibulum, occurs with poor quality food in young horses, occurs mostly in 4th, 5th and 6th upper cheek tooth, unilateral purulent nasal discharge there, fetid odor is there, whole head on one side, poor mastication, splitting of the tooth may occur, dental fistula may occur. Second is chronic ossifying alveolar periostitis occurs in horses in 2 to 3 years of the age, upper third cheek tooth is involved. Then productive periostitis and osteitis develops, newborn growth is there, bony enlargement is there. And then treatment, the mild blister, refining, repulsion of tooth should be carried out. Now that's how we apply a mouth gag. And that mouth gag, horse once applied, horse cannot close the mouth, and you can put your hand inside, put the instrument inside, and can see there is one hook which was not allowing proper mastication of the food, proper chewing of the food. So it was removed. Now this was a broken tooth, a splitted tooth, and the piece was removed. And then you can see the this is a motorized rasp which is being used. Now you can see here the retained baby incisors which is causing interference in the mastication. And you can use a flexi disc to rasp the sharp edges of the molars. Here, sharp edges of the molars, you can use the flexi disc. Now, dental floating is very important procedure, and here you can see sharp enamel points, and they do not allow proper mastication of the food, proper grinding of the teeth. It doesn't allow, and there is ulcer over here in the oral mucosa. So that's how this is enlarged. So you have to just rasp it by this on the lateral side, and now you can see the surfaces are flat after floating. So this is before floating and this is after floating, and that's how we accomplish this. And other dental abnormalities is severe waveform mouth, supernumerary teeth, a small wolf tooth is there. Now, we come to the orthopedic surgery or musculoskeletal system or arthroscopic surgery. You have to know very first the anatomy of forelimb and hind limb, and the flexor tendon, extensor tendon, and suspensory ligament, sesamoid bones. All these knowledge you should have. because unless you have knowledge, you cannot diagnose. Now here you can see in X-ray, there is one chip fracture of radial carpal bone. Here you can see. So you have to have a proper knowledge, and then fracture management of carpal bones is by plating, and you have to use the compression plates and the screws over here, and see the procedure is going on, and you have to have this in the orthopedic operation theater, and proper C-arm and other facilities should be there so that you know that what procedure is there and how deep the screw is going, and you can see the finished surgery and the plates are there, and you can see the screw in position, and you can see here also post-operative X-ray of these fractured bones, and this is in our department to be managed, the olecranon fracture in a mare, and site was prepared, and then these instruments were used, and as you know that tension bend wiring is being done in this case, and it was done and it was dressed, and you can see a proper weight bearing is there. Now there's a pool draft system, and sometimes after fracture repair some physiotherapy is given in this pool just to have a better musculoskeletal activities and good recovery. Now the fracture in the mandible is not transverse, you know, this is just horizontal, and they just split because horse falls down when these teeth incisors, they strike to the ground, and there is a splitting. It's a very easy to put the encircles wiring. You can see here, and this is in our department. We received one mare, and you can see encircles wiring. Two wires were put, stainless steel wire encircles under general anesthesia, and after 1.5 months, we removed these. There was a perfect healing. Now, arthritis is of course quite common in horses because these are using for the racing purposes, so there will be osteochondritis dissecans and spavin problem, side bone problem, navicular bone, splints, many form of these arthritis and orthopedic problem will be there. Now lameness is really a big science for the horses, you know, and if you are issuing one soundness certificate, you should be very well acquainted with the lameness and different body parts and swellings which are there, chronic swellings you must know, and so the anatomy of forelimb and hind limb, it's necessary you should know a name of all the bones, all the joints, and then you have to examine the horse in many ways, you know, in standing and in locomotion, and then it is taken on the soft ground, taken on the hard ground, and so that you know that which limb is showing lameness, and then many type of problems in the foot are diagnosed, like canker, like quitter, like corn, and the ring bone, there's a phalangeal exostosis, and you have to take a support of X-ray also, and here you can see high ring bone, low ring bone, this is a ring bone you can see, and you can see the model where the ring bone was there, this horse after euthanasia, the bone was taken out, and there was a, you can see ankylosis of the joint, that's how it looks like, and then correct foot and pastern axis, how it looks like, you know, foot and pastern axis, that straight line should bisect first, second and third digit in two halves, you know, this is the correct foot and pastern axis. If it is broken, that means the shoe is not in proper form, and you have to carry out the rasping. Laminitis or founder is really another very important problem, which is causing production losses. Sometimes there are deaths also. So you have to find out that what is the etiology of laminitis. There could be multiple etiologies, like grain founder, excessive feeding of the grain could be there, water founder, grass founder, road founder. So a lot of etiology factor are there, and you have to diagnose this. But ultimately what happens if you do not treat this in within 72 hours, there is a rotation of third phalanx, and it will just pierce through the sole, and it will come out, and that's the worst situation. and it will go in unfavorable prognosis. So you have to see that this is the normal, but in laminitis, once third phalanx rotates, because there is a pull of deep distal flexor tendon, and you can see the tip of the third phalanx is now causing pressure on the sole region, and it's coming out. So it is sinking. This is rotation is being done. So that's how we recall the pathology of this. If these cases are not treated, then you will see after 15 years how the overgrown hooves are there, and these horses were abandoned, and they are of no use now. Therapeutic exercise for the horses is very, very important. You know, there are many type of exercises and physiotherapy, many instruments also I will discuss later on, which are used only exclusively for the horse. Now, radial nerve paralysis, if you have put horse on the hard surface, then there could be radial nerve paralysis. If there is a hit at the humerus region, then there could be radial nerve paralysis. If there is a fracture of humerus, it could be there. And you have to, in initial stage, you can go for ice cold application and cold water fomentation, but in later on you can go for the heat therapy. And this is, as you know, that ultraviolet rays fomentation is there. Now, this is involuntary flexion of hind limb, hyperflexion, I must say, it touches the abdomen. We call this as a string halt. Prolonged hyperflexion of a limb, we call this as a string halt. And this is a real string halt condition. And if both the limbs are involved, then see how animal is in the air from the hind limbs. You cannot use this animal until unless you correct it. Now here you see, there is a lateral distal extensor tendon. This tendon you have to cut. You have to remove a big piece of tendon, upper one through the belly of muscle and lower one through the tendon. You have to cut and you have to remove, and the condition is cured. Now, string halt operation we have done in our department. You can see one incision above the hock, one is incision below the hock. You can see both the incisions, and this tendon was cut, muscle belly was cut, and you can see in here, this is muscle belly and this is the tendon. And after that, this was all right. These are sutures. Upward fixation of patella, this is as you see in cattle, it's the same. Stifle is locked and there is a overextension, and it will just pull it. You can see it. Hind limb is abducted and raised, and you can see locking of the patella, dragging of the limb, and medial patellar desmotomy is the only answer. And you can see how it is done in the same way which you do in the cows. You can do in a standing position, you can do in lateral recumbency, as you prefer. You have to extrudize the medial patellar ligament, and then desmotomy has to be done. Then fibrotic and ossifying myopathy in horses, these are important. And classical sign for this, since three muscles are involved, the semitendinosus, biceps femoris, and semimembranosus, and there are reasons. So when the horse is moving, it cannot put its foot just in front, rather it will give jerk and it will bring it 3 to 5 inch behind. So this jerking and bringing foot 3 to 5 inch behind means these muscles are not working properly due to adhesions, and you have to carry out the treatment accordingly. So managing club foot is there by putting the shoe with the clips, side clips. Now foot hoof pattern access is very, very important. You know, these are, you know, two straight lines. One straight line should bisect first, second, third phalanx in two halves. It should run parallel to the wall of the hoof, and we call this the hoof pattern access. And if this is broken, that means it is going to cause any hoof problem, either exostosis or any other problem, and you have to take help of farrier to correct it. I
know what has happened. Yeah.
Now, again, here you can see the hoof pasture axis. This is a straight one, and these are a broken one. You can see. Punctured wounds, you can see the foreign bodies, they puncture through the sole and they can reach even up to the navicular bursa or below, causing leaving the infection. And you have to detect the foreign body using the hoof tester. If you take x-ray, you can detect the foreign body, and sometimes the tip of foreign body is not visible. So you have to go for x-ray and then you have to do it. Now here you can see the nail over here. It was nail over here, which was detected in lateral x-ray. Side bones, there is ossification of collateral cartilage. Sometimes this is fractured, and after fracture, they cause pain, and then you have to treat it accordingly. And pastern joint fusion is being done, particularly if there is an articular ring bone, then you have to go for fusion of this. Neurectomy is done, particularly if there is a foot disorder, maybe a navicular bone, maybe a ring bone, maybe a side bone, and it is not treatable, then you have to carry out the neurectomy operation, and which is very simple, can be done under local anesthesia in a standing position. And posterior digital neurectomy is being done. This is an anesthesia surgeons are doing. And you can see here the nerve is elevated and neurectomy is being performed. And now animal cannot feel the pain and it can walk normally after neurectomy. Now, equine podiatry is really very, very important science to take care of the hoof and foot particularly. So we say that no foot, no horse, so hoof trimming and shoeing is therefore very, very important. Now, farrier instruments, we must acquaint, you know. Farriers are very, very important scientific people for the stud farm, those who are keeping equines, because farrier has to pay a visit every 2 weeks to the horse to see the hoof, whether there is it is going abnormally. He has to shape the hoof, he has to clean the hoof, and it detects any pathology over there. So these instruments are there in farrier set, and we should know all these instruments and see how this farrier is doing, and he is having all his kit with him, and horse cooperates like anything. And you, this shoeing is being done as hot shoeing and cold shoeing. You can see this is a hot shoeing, red hot is there, and then cold shoeing, this is cold shoeing which is done, it is not made hot. And then when there is a hoof cracks, then you have to apply certain clips over here so that cracks doesn't widen over here. Now here you can see the plates are being screwed, small screw, so that more widening doesn't take place and you can carry out the dressing, and how trimming, therapeutic trimming is being done. Now arthroscopy in horses is very, very important. There are big books on the arthroscopy of the horse, and you can see how diagnostic and surgical arthroscopy in horse is being done. And now lot of problem into the joint, like bone spavin, like chip fractures are there, and you have to go for arthroscopy. And you can see here surgeons, while putting arthroscope into the joint, they can see on the TV screen that what is the pathology involved over there. And here you can see the OCD, bone pieces over there, and they are being removed. And here you can see arthroscope into the joint, and here also you can see the arthroscope into the carpal joint or knee joint, here also in the knee joint. And you can see osteochondritis dissecans, OCD fragments, which you can see very well, and these are being removed by the alligator forceps of arthroscope. So arthroscopic surgery is really these days a boon for the sports horses, because it's a minimum invasive surgery, and horse can be back to the work very soon. particularly after removal of the diseased bone and cartilage. So all the joints, in all the joints of the horses, arthroscopy can be done. Now, wound healing in horses is a big challenge. And why it is a big challenge? It's not like that in the other species that you just dress and wound is healed within few days. No. You have to follow protocols of wound healing, and you have to find out that what is the cause that wound is not healing. And many times the surgical wound heals faster than these wounds. And open wounds, they convert into granulating wound, and you keep on changing antibiotic, you keep on changing topical ointments, and nothing happens until unless you follow certain rules. Now, when wounds, they don't heal promptly, there is always a reason until you figure out that it never healed. So one is the infection. And you will be really surprised to know that bacteria, they feel happy to grow in high pH, alkaline pH. So make the wound pH acidic pH. You just clean the infected wound, remove the debris, dead tissue, and reduce the number of bacteria, and this has become acidic, and the infection will be minimized. So there are 12 point inhibitors of wound healing, and the Norton Belt list of 12 factors that stop wound healing we are discussing here. Foreign bodies in the wound, they stop wound healing, and it could be wooden splinter, dirt, grass. You can see here the foreign bodies, they stop healing over here. Then tissue deficits, your biological foundation, loss of tissue is there. You have to carry out, put some biological scaffold using collagen, amnion, intestine from other animals, and then the healing will be faster. And you can see here a dermal graft which is placed over a wound, and the wound heals faster with this. Then movement should not be allowed at the site. Necrotic tissue should be removed, and blood supply, if it is reduced, healing will be delayed. Poor oxygenation of that tissue will cause problem in the healing. If tissue is looking purple, means it's a poor in oxygen. So you have to make it rich in oxygen supply. Hyperbaric chambers are these days used to increase the oxygen into the tissue. Continued trauma should not be there at the wound. Some local factors. What are these local factors? If it is too cold, wound won't heal. If it is too hot, wound won't heal. If it is too wet, it won't heal. If it is too dry, then also it won't heal. So you have to provide ideal condition. Poor health, overall health, has poor immunity, more infection will be there. Poor nutrition causes delay wound healing. Iatrogenic idiocy. What is this iatrogenic idiocy? There are many stupid things that people adopt. Like they make some homemade preparation to apply topically on the wound, and wound never heals, you know. So don't apply homemade preparation on the horse wounds. Then tumor transformation. Certain wounds which are of long standing cases, and they develop tumors in them due to transformation, and they won't heal. So you have to take care of the wound, apply proper dressing, proper support to the wound. This is a case of burn in the foot, and you have to apply proper dressing and bandaging to these cases, otherwise it won't heal. So wound on the neck, you have to apply antiseptic dressing and adhesive tape. Now, certain accidental cases, you just have a look that a penetrating wound in the thoracic cavity, you can see wooden stack, it was removed. And this case I'm showing you, this happened in our NCC wing, and there was a horse who disengaged the pipe and it passed through the neck. And this horse is not a real horse, and it's just a simulation of accident site. You can see a lot of blood over there. Here, this was the horse, which was quite notorious, and pipe passed from left side to right side. And you can see the jugular was ruptured from one side, and there was severe bleeding. And this was the pipe, and you can detect the blood staining up to here, more than, I must say, 30 inches it was there, and it passed through one side to other side. and then immediately it was put down under general anesthesia, ketamine, xylazine, and you can see the tunnel where pipe was passed and the ligation was done, sucing was done, and fluid therapy was given throughout night, and the dressing was sutures were opened after 72 hours, and the packing was removed, and the open wound dressing was allowed, and then the betadine solution was used, and GIP was used. BIP or GIP was used. This is a very good dressing agent, and now you can see this white line, epithelial lining, you can see that indicates healing, and gradually you can see left and right side, both side, it completely healed. This horse is still surviving, still there in our NCC wing. The management of wounds of glans penis and effect of ACP. Now, how to detect, how to take out the penis and to see the wound on the glans? You have to use the acetylpromazine, which relaxes the retractor penile muscle, and penis will be paralyzed, and you can say it is out after 7 minutes, and then you can see the wound on the tip here, on the tip, and then you can dress it. Now, the periocular hemorrhagemia is there, proper debridement is being done, and you can see the healing of long time. Now, pectoral wound management, they need really a very good tip. You all should note out, particularly those who are working in the field. You have to make a martingale rope like this so that horse cannot take its neck more up frequently, and wound will heal after debridement, and you can put any antiseptic. We used BIP, bismuth subnitrase, iodoform, paraffin paste, and you can see a very good healing. You can see this white epithelial lining is coming, and there is no discharge from the granulation tissue. You can see here the healing has started, wound has started shrinking. Lacerated wounds, they come very frequently. Again, you have to apply martingale rope. Here you can see a very big neck wound, martingale rope was applied so that wound is not widened up, neck doesn't go up, and this is complete healing here, the neck wound. Cosmetic surgery of ears, lips, and nostril is sometimes done. You can see here there was a laceration of the ear, and you can apply this artificial graft inside to give a support. And here you can see there was agenesis of the lip on this side, and here lateral incisors, they were enlarged, and this is the infraorbital nerve block, and site was prepared, and approximation was done, and if a piece of skin was removed, and this was apposed, vertical matrix sutures were applied, and these enlarged teeth were removed. Two teeth were removed. Now this is before and this is after. Now you cannot see these two teeth, they were removed. And another case which met with an automobile accident, you can see the frontal sinuses were open, and the flat bones were broken, and this was also done in a standing position, and bones were sutured together by stainless steel wire, and reconstruction surgery was done. It took us 3 hours. It was a 9-month pregnant mare, and which folded successfully later on. Now, skin grafting was done clinically in our department. Now you can see that one unskilled person, he put a colic injection here with unsterilized syringe, and you can see the loss of skin over here, such a big wound, and maggots were there, and it was first treated, and it's yellow thing you can see, this is BIP, bismuth subnitrile iodoform paraffin paste, and now you can see the healing. This white epithelium, you can see it's coming up, but still the wound was very big, so I decided to go for a grafting, you know. So full thickness skin graft was taken, it was made, and it was not cut from here, blood supply was intact, and this was cut from here through a tunnel. It was taken to the site, it was sutured over here on one side. After 48 hours, we were so happy that still blood supply was there, it was taken up. Other side, it was taken up, and gradually now you can see it became island, it started releasing the epithelium, and then you can see wound started narrowing down, more and more epithelium was coming up. After 2 months, you can see healing was there at considerable area, and you can see this before and this is after. So in successive pictures, you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, and that's how the healing occurred. On medial side also, you can see the healing occurred. we use ultrasonic therapy also for this. Now, split thickness sheet grafting is also used many times. You can see power-driven dermatome you can use, and then you can make meshing of sheet graft, and this meshing is applied over an area where there is a skin loss, and over the granulation tissue you can apply this, and you can see here it was taken up, and the small islands are there of epithelium. You can see here punch graft are placed at the granulation tissue, and these are taken up and healing is going on. Now see the epithelium is being released over here, healing is taking place. So you can see here that how healing takes place after grafting. This is first and this is last, and healing is taking place. Now in equines, there are a lot of advancement in sports medicine is there to increase the performance, swimming pools and a lot of other things are there. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy is there for the sick horses, and here oxygen will reach to the blood as much as 15 times normal levels, and this will give more oxygen to the tissue, and that will heal faster. Rehabilitation slings are necessary, particularly in cases of tendon ligament injuries, fractures, you have to use rehabilitation slings. Equine solarium infrared light therapy is necessary that offers vitamin D and a relaxing therapy to horses that are having body or back sore. It reduces body soreness, improves circulation, and a positive hair cord. So this is exclusively for the horses. Laser therapy, therapeutic laser is there for the horses, particularly for musculoskeletal disorders. Infrared therapy is there for the horses, and equine light therapy is there for the horses to treat horses to improve the circulation. And here again, this is laser therapy going on. So equine sport medicine centers are there in many countries, and they really have exclusive instruments to help horses. Particularly, a water treadmill is there to carry out the exercise for the horses. You can see equine water treadmill where the floor moves, horse is standing in the water. Now to detect the respiratory disease, bronchoalveolar lavage, BAL, BAL is there, and you can see that's how they just collect the air and lavas, and that transtracheal aspiration and this lavas developing tranquilizer for breath samples. Certain volatile chemicals in exhaled gases are linked to some illnesses, so it's important, you know. But these days even horses looking in this cartoon, that let me see what are stem cells. Stem cell therapy is really very good adjunct to treat the lamenesses, certain types of lamenesses. So you can see here the stem cell therapy of this hip joint is being carried out, and stem cell can be stored and can be injected and commercially available as well. You can see stem cells can be applied. Now amputee horses are being applied prosthesis and artificial limbs, and they are being given a wheelchair car, and you can see how this amputee horse is moving. The swimming pools are there for the exercise. And now to increase the cellular metabolism, helping cells to utilize oxygen, there is PEMF, pulse electromagnetic field. That's an electrically charged magnetic field that stimulates the cellular structure. This is a new thing in the horses, and in all racing horses, they are using it to stimulate the cellular structure. And these are the points where you can use this. These are master points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, where you can use, and at a different region. And there are specific advantages. And 2 minutes on each point, pain point, you can use this. So, gentlemen, what is the future of equine surgery? What we need? We need more advances in colic surgery, because the colic is an all-round problem of equines, you know. So, with a faster treatment, more effective treatment, and a very quick recovery, we want to have a very good technology for this. Now, the thoracic surgery is also picking up now in horses. First cardiac ablation in horse was also being done. So advances in thoracic surgery is also being needed to treat certain congenital or acquired cardiac defects or some thoracic ailments. Now, upper airway diseases are very common. So advances in upper airway disease surgery should also be done. And this is need of the hour. Then animal is used, horse is used for sports purposes. So advances in equine sports injury is must. And we should open more and more equine sport injury centers so that these can be treated. Now, robotic surgery using minimum invasive surgery, that's the latest advancement. And these days in humans, this is being used. Canines, this is used for equines at many centers. This is being used. The future vision is the cyber knife. Now, cyber knife is the world's first and only robotic radio surgery system. It is a non-invasive alternative to surgery. And you can use this for both the cancerous and non-cancerous tumors anywhere in the body. It provides pain-free, non-surgical option for patients who have inoperable or surgically complex tumors. Treatment delivers beams of high-dose radiation to tumors with extreme accuracy. Benefits of CyberKnife treatment is pain-free, non-invasive, no anesthesia required, exceptional accuracy, no recovery time, immediate return to normal activity. Now, robotic-controlled equine imaging systems are there. And these are already there in many universities in the US. And this is need of hour now. And now, Penn VETS new Bolton Center in USA unveiled revolutionary robots to take the X-ray like this. Radiation therapy to treat various types of tumors in the horses. Really, these centers are required. And scintigraphy, also the use of radioisotopes to detect the tumors and organ structure and function. So we say that equine surgery is very special and needs good knowledge and experience. And we should be proud to call as an equine surgeon. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, now we will begin with the question answer session.
Yes.
The first question for you is, sir, what are the important factors related to treatment of enteric problem in equines, in which cases surgery can be avoided?
Oh, yes. In enteric problem, usually impactions are there. And if impactions are there and it is associated with colic, then you should go for very first liquid paraffin, oral administration of liquid paraffin, and give plenty of fluid therapy. And you can use even enema also. So try some non-surgical methods to relieve this. Usually the doctors, they don't give much of the fluid therapy. In equines, the fluid therapy in these cases must be given to the tune of 15 to 20 liters in a day. So it should be given in plenty, and the liquid paraffin should be used. And if nothing works within 48 hours, then one should go for surgery.
Thank you very much, sir. So the next question is, the attendee wants you to elaborate and explain us about guttural pouch approaches.
Yes, yes, sir. You see, you'll be very lucky if you see in your lifetime any affection of guttural pouch, because in my career of almost 40 years, I have seen two cases of guttural pouch affection. So guttural pouch, I always used to teach that approach to guttural pouch is through reverse triangle. And reverse triangle is located just posterior to the mandible. So it's very interesting that guttural pouch is distended and just posterior to the mandible. You can give incision because it is distended. So when you give incision on the skin, you are not going to injure any of the blood vessel, important blood vessel. And then you can go inside and you can do the needful. If it is empyema, then it's a different. If it is chondroid, then thing is different. If it is tympanitis, then things are different. So you can operate it. It's very simple to do. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Sir, the next question is, at what interval dental rasping should be done in equines?
Yes, this is a very pertinent question, because rasping cannot be done in one shift. You have to carry out several sessions to do rasping, because while doing rasping also we are injuring oral mucosa. So maybe that you need 2 to 3 sessions. So I recommend that twice in a week, at least 2 sessions should be there. And still, if some sharpening of the tooth is there, then you can carry out another 3rd session. But usually 2 to 3 sessions are enough.
Thank you, sir. Sir, that's all for the question answer session.
Thank you.
I would like to thank Dr. T.K. Gehlot sir for the excellent presentation. Sir, the information and knowledge imparted by you through the webinar prepares us to manage each surgical condition by understanding its pathophysiology and evaluating alternative surgical approaches. In addition to diagnostic imaging and orthopedic coverage, and also you have included in depth about anesthesia, integumentary system, elementary system, urogenital system, wound healing, skin grafting, stem cells, and other advanced techniques that are mandatory for equine surgery. Sir, the advances highlighted by you will lead to improved prediction of success, survival rates or better success rates, and decreased complication rates. Sir, you also described several modalities to combat, prevent, and manage challenges faced in equine surgery, which will help us or which will provide positive impact on updating our knowledges and also reduce the complications in equine surgery. I would also like to thank the President of the Society, Simrat Sagar Singh sir, and the Executive Secretary, Dr. Deepak Patil sir, for their constant support and guidance for this webinar. Further, I would like to thank the webinar team, Dr. Deepak Tiwari and Dr. Nilesh Sindhu from LUAS Hisar, along with INTAS Animal Health team, Dr. Nitin Bhatia and Dr. Aman Jyot for their constant support. Further, at last but not the least, I would like to thank the attendees for their patience hearing. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you also. A great team of INTAS and ISVS, and including President and General Secretary. And really, it was a great pleasure to be again here second time on this platform. And I was really thrilled to prepare this topic, and hope I did justification with the topic, and maybe that some of feedbacks I receive on my email or on my WhatsApp from my students or those who attended this. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.